Today, as we strive for a new beginning to the 21st century, I believe everyone, every man, woman, and child, should have quality, affordable health care in America. Unfortunately, back in 1993 and 94, too many of our opponents adopted a strategy that amounted to just say no. My Republican opponents will try to equate health care for all Americans with government-run health care. Well, don't let them fool us again.
Here's what would happen under our proposed budget, what we're calling the path to prosperity. As you can see, we won't come anywhere close to the tipping point, and we'll pay off the debt over time. So how will we do it? We will cut spending.
So cutting spending reduces our debt. Hey, you know what else might work? Give me some of that creepy music. Computer graphics askew, please. What if we also attack our deficit by getting rid of the Bush tax cuts? Oh, look at that!
All righty, live look at Capitol Hill, 6 o'clock on the East Coast. Good morning, everyone.
President Obama has just signed that 2011 budget deal that keeps the federal government running, but vowing to get serious about America's fiscal crisis, House Republicans today pushed through a budget blueprint that would slash spending by trillions of dollars in the next decade. At the core, a dramatic overhaul of Medicare and Medicaid. Democrats are now vowing to dig in and defend what they are calling the sacred contract with the American people. Let's go straight to Capitol Hill. Our senior congressional correspondent, Dana Bash, is just standing by. This all promises, Dana, based on the early rhetoric, to get pretty ugly.
It already is. Republicans are saying that they should be rewarded for offering bold ideas to tackle some issues like the deficit that Congress has let spiral for years. But dealing with Medicare, trying to overhaul that, that is rough political terrain for Republicans, and Democrats are happy to play there.
You didn't even have to go inside the Capitol to know where the day's political battle lines were drawn.
Hands off my Medicare.
Democrats enlisted seniors like Josephine to help rail against the Republican budget.
They are out to destroy Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. There is a time to draw a line in the sand and fight.
The House Republican budget calls for trillions of dollars in spending cuts and deficit reduction, in part by overhauling Medicare, creating a new system where seniors buy their own subsidized private insurance.
Biggest threat to Medicare is the status quo. Medicare goes bankrupt in 9 years.
House Budget Chairman Paul Ryan argued vigorously for his plan.
Let the 40 million seniors in Medicare be in charge of their Medicare program. And more importantly, we save Medicare, prevent its bankruptcy. And what does the other side do? They sit by and watch the program go bankrupt.
Every single Democrat voted no.
The Republican budget breaks the promise that this country has made to seniors, that after a lifetime of work, they will be able to depend on Medicare to protect them in retirement.
Democrats are practically giddy about the politics of this, calling it a defining vote. They've already written TV ads to run against vulnerable Republicans.
We're going to use robocalls, web ads, television, radio. We're going to remind the American people that today they voted to terminate Medicare with all the tools in our toolbox.
Their targets, Republicans like freshman Patrick Meehan, who voted yes.
Any trepidation about voting for this Republican budget?
Well, certainly, everybody, you think about the implications.
His Pennsylvania district has a big senior population and seniors vote. He already has multiple events scheduled back home to beat back Democratic charges.
Republicans today voted on a budget that gives the wealthiest Americans another tax break, slashes benefits for everyone else, and maybe gives Democrats a campaign gift.
The main act is the Ryan budget.
The concurrent resolution is agreed to.
first, only one of them owned it. Now they all do. House Republicans vote in overwhelming numbers for the Tea Party-inspired Medicare-killing, government-slashing Paul Ryan budget.
Something happened last November, and the American people gave the keys to this town to the Republicans.
Do you realize that your leadership is asking you to cast a vote today to abolish Medicare as we know it?
Democrats are saying this is crazy.
It's the same old ideological agenda, except this time on steroids.
This Medicare plan will completely change the structure.
That ends Medicare for senior citizens.
Substantial changes in Medicare.
Republicans have a new hero. Democrats have a new target.
Congressman Ryan's plan.
Congressman Ryan's approach.
Paul Ryan's budget.
The Ryan plan.
Yes! Paul Ryan's presentation was thrilling.
This is the same guy who voted for two wars, Bush tax cuts, the prescription drug bill, but wasn't paid for.
Good evening from New York today. Congressman Paul Ryan's budget plan became the House Republicans' budget plan. This afternoon, the House voted to adopt Ryan's 2012 budget proposal, which would cut $6.2 trillion in spending over the next 10 years. All but four Republicans voted yes, and every Democrat casting the easiest vote of their careers voted no. Just before the vote, Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi, who should by now be an expert on the price of tough votes, went to the floor and offered this warning to Republicans.
I want to say to my Republican colleagues, do you realize that your leadership is asking you to cast a vote today to abolish Medicare as we know it? Because that is the vote that we have. This is not about an issue. This is about a value. This is about an ethic. Medicare is a core value of our social compact with the American people.
And then 235 Republicans cast that vote, and the congressional election campaign was on.
This Republican budget stops Medicare. It puts an end to Medicare.
They end Medicare as you know it, as we all know it.
The Republican plan destroys Medicare.
They were willing to break the social contract in our country.
This was wrong, 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 and I'm glad to be on the right side of history.
Speaker Boehner reminded the members as they were about to run off for 2 weeks recess that there is much more governing to be done.
So the president asked Congress to raise the debt limit without addressing Washington's spending problem. The president wants a clean bill. And the American people will not tolerate it. Now let me be clear. There will be no debt limit increase unless it's accompanied by serious spending cuts and real budget reform.
Congressman Chris Van Hollen, the ranking member of the Budget Committee, accurately countered that debt ceiling argument with the fact that the debt ceiling would be a recurring problem even if the Republican plan became law.
I would point out that even if we adopt the Republican budget, we're going to have to lift the debt ceiling for years and years to come. So let's not play Russian roulette with the economy and the full faith and credit of the United States government.
Joining me now is Democratic Congressman Peter Welsh, who represents the one and only congressional district of Vermont. Thank you very much for joining us tonight, Congressman.
Good to be here.
Congressman, the Democrats are saying that the Republicans voted to end Medicare today. Republicans say, no. They voted to reform and to save Medicare. So I want to read you something from the referee. I want to read you a description of what the Congressional Budget Office says would happen if the Republican plan became law, the Medicare plan. People who turn 65 in 2022 or later years, and disability insurance beneficiaries who become eligible for Medicare in 2022 or later would not enroll in the current Medicare program, but instead would be entitled to a premium support payment to help them purchase private insurance. That reads to me, Congressman, from CBO, that these people voted to end Medicare.
Well, they did. I mean, that's exactly what it is.
you know, Congressman Ryan is saying the cost of Medicare is too much, and I think the Democrats have to acknowledge that the cost of health care, not just Medicare, is too much, and that's why we need to reform the way we deliver health care. But Medicare has been successful because it's an entitlement. It's successful because seniors are able to select their doctor, go to the hospital of their choice, and it really is, in effect, a one-payer. They pay for this throughout their lives, as we all do, and then when they need it, they know it's there. What the Ryan proposal does is basically turn that into a private insurance program. So all of the hassles that all of us experience who are trying to deal with private insurance, those would now become the burden of anyone who's 55 and becomes 65 in 2022. So it really does take away the government-sponsored program of Medicare and turn it over to you, each of us individually, to go buy health insurance in the private market. And what the CBO also said is it would cost every senior about $6,000 more a year. So it would end Medicare as we know it.
Well, it would cost those seniors $6,000 more a year if they could afford a policy that fit them and fit their conditions and fit their situations. There could be many situations where people simply fall through the cracks and they cannot afford the policy that may or may not exist for them out there.
Well, see, that's true. And also, you know, as you know, the Republicans also abolished in the House the health care bill that was passed and sponsored by President Obama. And that had in it some very important insurance reforms, so that if you have a pre-existing condition, you can still buy insurance. So can you imagine what it would be like for somebody 55, and most of us by the time we're 55 have some condition that's going to need medical attention, that an insurance company could charge us whatever they wanted or deny us coverage altogether. So that's what awaits us with the Ryan approach on Medicare. It's very, very, very dangerous, actually.
Good evening, Americans, and welcome to The Ed Show tonight from New York. Well, the Republicans finally voted to kill Medicare. And do you think that I'm going to be quiet about that on Bill Maher? I don't think so. It was a shout fest. This is The Ed Show. Let's get to work.
That's
a voucher
right.
program
and
is going
thing.
To cheat people in the latter
it
part of
not.
Their... It will.
The it will not.
Friday, it was me and Michael Steele on Bill Maher. Today, Republicans are mounting a new offensive to kill Medicare. Sarah Palin goes to Madison and the grassroots activists drown her out.
I'm standing no more than 100 yards away from the stage where Sarah Palin is speaking, and I can't hear a single word she's saying.
And oh, you're going to want to see that. But this is the story that has me fired up first tonight. The Republicans, they're on the move. They're on the attack. They're after the New Deal. And it's finally on paper, just as we've called for years. House Republicans passed their blueprint for burning America's social safety net on Friday. Now, that evening, I had the opportunity to be on Real Time with Bill Maher and debate former RNC chair Michael Steele. I had a lot of fun. Now, the conversation I had with Steele pretty much lit up the internet all weekend long. So let's take a look at how it was played out. It's just a big shout fest. I mean, we almost came to blows. It was unreal. Huffington Post, Ed Schultz, Michael Steele have shouting match on Bill Maher. There was some other stuff out there. Gawker had. Watch Ed Schultz and Michael Steele yell at each other on Real Time. And then, of course, there was another outfit, Mediaite. They were saying Bill Maher, Ed Schultz, Michael Steele have shout fest debate on the budget. Now, you see, the word shouts in there a lot. What do you want me to do? I have done town hall meetings all over America. I have talked to middle classers, tell me that they are financially under attack. And here comes the final blueprint from the Republicans via Paul Ryan that, yes, they are going after Medicare, Medicaid, and Social Security. How can you not get cranked up if you believe in the institutions that made this country great? Let me show you what the websites missed. Steele gave this, I thought, amazing answer on Paul Ryan's plan to turn Medicare into a voucher program. Take a look.
What happens to a person if this plan is enacted who uses the $15,000, which, by the way, if they're in an assisted living facility, they'll go through it in 3 months. You know, what happens to them? What do they do when they use up the $15,000 by this time of the year?
They get inferior care.
What happens for the rest of the year? What happens to them?
They're SOL.
What happens? I'm just asking.
We don't know yet because...
That's right. We don't know.
All right.
Here's
Look, seriously, can we just have an intelligent conversation without all the noise for a second? This is just the beginning of a framework. Just as people disagree with parts of what the president has put on the table.
A voucher program. I've listened to you. Disagree. Okay, now it's my turn. Okay, a voucher program is privatization. A voucher program is going to cheat people in the latter part of their... It will. The care won't be the same.
What proof do you have, or what evidence do you have to say that?
You go to a doctor right now, when you're on Medicare, it's paid for, no matter what the treatment is. Under your plan, that will not happen. And I am saying something...
How do you know that? How do you know that?
Well, it's in your plan.
How do you know that?
A voucher program will not...
Does it say in the plan it will not cover
everything? Well, it's a number,
so you're saying... No, I'm going to get this on record. You're saying that a voucher program is better than Medicare?
It's a number.
Are you willing to say that?
I'm willing to say this if we're going to give it a try and make all the right parameters.
No, no,
absolutely.
We're in absolute territory.
Okay.
Well, Mr. Steele, first, the former head of the RNC, first, he doesn't know, but he wants to have an intelligent conversation. And then secondly, we just have to give it a try. Oh, what the hell? Let's just wing it. What do you say we just wing it with this healthcare thing? I don't care what any website has to say. What Republicans, when they spit that kind of garbage out, Democrats have every right to fight for protecting the institutions that made this country great. So far this year, let's take a good look at this. Republicans, well, they have attacked what? Public pensions, public education, collective bargaining, unions, Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security, and the entire social net has been on the table. Why? Because they want more tax cuts. Now, I've spoken with thousands of working Americans who want the Democrats to fight back against the attack on the pocketbooks. Now, the middle class is sick of the Republicans steamrolling in the debate, and I think they're just screaming out for justice. Somebody's got to stand up and say something, like loud, like I did the other night. This is no time to play nice with conservatives the way they're playing with the numbers. When it comes to protecting Medicare for the American people, as Democrats, we have to fight hard. But you know what? The people are on our side. I'm a liberal. It's a liberal program, and people poll big time. Last month's NBC News Wall Street Journal poll found that only 16% of Americans want a complete overhaul of the system known as Medicare. The USA Today Gallup poll this week shows that, well, 13%, there's a whopping number for you, they want a complete overhaul. The numbers aren't there, folks. What do you think the Republicans would be saying if they had those kind of numbers? Democrats need to hammer Republicans with these numbers. Democrats also need to remember just how hard and how long the party fought to get Medicare. LBJ's words on the day he signed the Medicare bill back in 1965, I think they still ring very true today. He said, "No longer will older Americans be denied the healing miracle of modern medicine. No longer will illness crush and destroy the savings they have so carefully put away over a lifetime so that they might enjoy dignity in their later years. No longer will young families see their incomes and their hopes eaten away simply because they are carrying out the deep moral obligation to their parents and to their uncles and their aunts. And no longer will the nation refuse the hand of justice to those who have given a lifetime of service and wisdom and labor to the progress of this progressive country." LBJ couldn't have said it any better. JFK couldn't have said it any better. And we as liberals in this country have to realize that it's not hard to stand up to the Michael Steeles of the world or any other righty out there that's spewing out a bunch of stuff about having an intelligent conversation, but we got to wing it. We really don't know yet. Let's just do it for the money. See, back in that generation, it wasn't all about the money. It was about people. People made a difference back then. And where are people Democrats now? What do we want? You see, this blowing up the federal budget deficit to the point of no return has brought us right where the conservative movement has wanted us to be for decades. Here at the baseline of getting us liberals to talk about, yeah, let's cut it. And they speak from a position of strength. Listen to Senator Tom Coburn, a member of this Gang of Six. Did you know that a Gang of Six is thinking about coming up with a plan to get rid of the big three? Oh, yeah, they're really going to raise taxes. No, they're not. Republicans are never going to vote to raise taxes. It's doctrine for them not to raise taxes. But listen to the way Mr. Coburn positions the Republicans in this argument.
there's a good chance that we'll be able to come up with a bipartisan agreement that people can swallow. You can't criticize Paul Ryan's plan until you have one that accomplishes the same thing. The president's doesn't come close to that.
Really? Now, he says he thinks they're going to come up with a bipartisan agreement. Now, this is on the heels of what I had just put up here about the big three that they've gone after, collective bargaining and, of course, the big three, on the heels of a record number of filibusters in the Senate. All of a sudden, they're going to do a deal. Who? The Democrats are going to do a deal? We're buying into their lingo. We're buying into their jargon. We're buying into their vernacular the wrong way. We should be saying, it's off the table. Now, do you want to talk? It's off the table. What has been great for the American people for decades is the mission for senators in Washington to make sure that people get mad at you and it's a big fun game. Hell no. This is about doing it for the people. And there is no poll out there that says that this is what the people want. The erosion of these institutions that have supported middle-class families. Folks, do you realize what a voucher is? A voucher means that you're not going to get anywhere near the care. Your mom and dad, they're not going to get anywhere near the care that your grandparents had if this goes through. That you, the young folks of America, are going to be fencing for yourselves late in life. And you know what? This program works. It's the Republicans who want to tear it down. Of course, they want to run everything. Let's see how it worked out there last year when Bush was in office in 2008. We spent $2.3 trillion on health care in 2008, the last year that they had the Oval Office. Most of the money, 31%, went to hospital care, 21% went to physician clinical services. Where do you think the old folks are in this? Where do you think Medicare and Medicaid is? It's over here, and that's what they want to cut. Why? Well, they want more tax cuts. They want to make sure that they can create more jobs, get more wealth, and get this economy going. It's a red herring. But what grates on me is when a good lefty like me stands up and gets after it, well, it's a shouting match. You're damn right it's a shouting match. The country ought to be shouting about this. The country ought to be shouting about the fact that there are six members of Congress who think they have the answer. They do not have the poll numbers on their side, and they don't have the formula for making a voucher program any better for middle-class families. Middle-class families have been under attack, and the attack is going to continue if the Republicans take control. The good news is for us, they have finally put it on paper and we know exactly who they are.
We've got some news in. The House just voted on the Ryan budget proposal. Kelly O'Donnell is standing by. Kelly, what's the latest?
Well, Tamron, they have not gaveled and called it a final vote yet, but they have surpassed the number needed to pass this. So Republicans have been able to pass the Ryan budget, which is a comprehensive budget to try to reduce the deficit. But the most controversial feature is how it would change Medicare for those people who are 55 and younger. So what's interesting here, too, four Republicans so far have voted for this. Against it. No Democrats voting for it. So very party line vote here. And they just haven't gaveled it yet, but we're close. So it looks like Paul Ryan was able to get through his budget. Not a surprise, but it's just a moment in time for Republicans to try to shine a light on what they think they can accomplish with reducing the deficit, while Democrats are definitely talking about what happens to Medicare.
All right. Thank you very much, Kelly O'Donnell, the latest on Capitol Hill. Home field advantage is doing little for Republicans trying to appeal to constituents about their party's plan to trim the federal budget. For example, GOP Budget Committee Chairman Paul Ryan was bombarded by hecklers in his home state of Wisconsin while talking changes to Medicare. The heckling was so severe that he was forced to dodge protesters in a police car.
My concern is that my 48-year-old son is not going to have Medicare.
Do not renew the Bush tax credit for the wealthy.
Elsewhere in places like Florida and North Carolina, congressional Republicans are running into similar roadblocks. NBC's Kelly O'Donnell has more from Capitol Hill. And Kelly, you talk with Congressman Ryan. Certainly he is standing by the mindset that he's trying to do what's best for America, for the future of this country. But you hear there when you start talking about cuts and entitlements, people certainly can turn angry. That's what we're seeing.
We do see emotion, and I spent a long day with Ryan yesterday in Wisconsin going from one town hall to the next. And when you see them in the fullness of an hour, you do get a range of people's reactions. Certainly increasingly those who are most angry tend to get our attention, and they bring points that they don't feel are satisfied by Ryan's explanations.
Paul Ryan says that his plan for Medicare is not rationing. I want your response to that.
Well, of course, it's rationing. I mean, his plan for Medicare actually reduces by about $6,000 to $7,000 per Medicare recipient. This is what the Congressional Budget Office has said, what they would ordinarily get. I mean, this is a huge rationing program. And then you ask yourself, where do those $6,000 and $7,000 go? Well, they go into the pockets of very wealthy Americans because Paul Ryan is going to reduce the taxes of the super rich. I mean, this is a transfer program from Medicare recipients to the super rich. It's all now down in their blueprint. It is now signed. It's not going to be sealed and delivered because I think the president and Democrats now are going to be able to rally the public against this.
Well, that's a big call. You think they are going to rally themselves? I mean, we know where the public is. There's no outcry from the American people to change what has been good for families in this country since 1965, and it took the Democrats 22 years to get it passed in the first place. It was a heavy lift, and it's worked. It saved lives. It saved people's bank accounts. Well, Republicans are waging a campaign of deceit to kill Medicare. So unlike them. If you don't believe me, just keep it right here. I'll tell you how they're doing it. This is The Ed Show. Let's get to work.
The vocal majority continues to fight Republicans all over the nation. We'll show you the tape. As you get pinched at the pump, word today that Big Oil is expecting record profits this year. Good thing their Republican pals voted to extend their taxpayer-funded subsidies. Tonight's takedown, a new low for Scott Walker. He's taking credit for jobs he didn't create.
And it's good to have you with us tonight. This is the story that has me fired up first. How about this? Campaign of deceit, so unlike the Republicans. Once again, they are trying to run and hide from the vote that they took on the Ryan budget last week. Last Thursday, the key question here, folks, I asked former RNC Chair Michael Steele this question. Do you think the Republicans can win on what they voted on in the House on the Ryan budget?
I do. I think Republicans will have a very good case to take to the American people. And ultimately, as you and I know, they will decide where they want this thing to come
okay.
out.
Okay. Oh, yes, they will decide. Mr. Steele, good sport coming to the program, but he is completely wrong. House Republicans are planning a conference call for tomorrow to start the old damage control on the Ryan budget. A Republican source with knowledge of the call told the National Journal, the call is intended to help swing district members who have been getting the crap kicked out of them. Now the source is telling us this, that this is what they're going to be talking about.
You did not run on any, you said nothing in the campaign about I'm going to change Medicare. Now you voted for a plan that will destroy Medicare.
Well, I won't destroy Medicare. Medicare is going to be destroyed by itself.
I have a great way for you to pay for it.
If you voted to abolish Medicare, how will you explain that to people who are in their 50s, who are out of work, that they will have not the Medicare that I have? Let me be clear.
You asked if I voted to abolish Medicare, but I
did
not.
Well, you did vote to abolish Medicare. That's what his vote is.
Well, show me how the Ryan budget that you just voted for brings down.
I don't have the chart for you, but
you don't have the chart here.
Well, suppose you want me to send it to you via email? Give me your email.
No, I know what chart you used. It came from the Heritage Foundation.
Is this the crowd they voted for last November? Callers to my radio show tell me that Paul Ryan is going to get the same kind of treatment and questions at four separate listening sessions in Wisconsin tomorrow around the state. Now, Ryan and other members of his caucus, basically what they need is a different strategy to convince 80%. I love this number. I told you I was going to show it to you a lot. 80%. Of Americans who want Republicans to keep their mitts off Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid, the big three. Republicans don't care if they win on the issue. See, right now the strategy is just to muddy the waters. Republican Party official told the Washington Post, Republicans don't want to be talking about Medicare every day for the next year and a half. Well, guess what? But if they keep the conversation on broader issues of spending and taxes, they can win. The official went on to say Republicans, quote, can fight the Medicare issue to a tie by muddying the waters? In other words, Republicans are openly admitting that they are going to flat out lie about Medicare. They just took the vote. House Democrats, they ought to be, and they finally are jumping all over Republicans for lying about this issue. The DCCC put out this commercial today. I'm happy.
Social Security and Medicare are a promise we have made to our seniors, and I will keep that promise. I'll never put our seniors' future at risk. No cuts, no privatization, and no scaring our seniors.
Turning Medicare into a voucher program, privatizing Social Security, the agenda of a party that he hopes to put into power.
If that's the agenda, I'm not voting for.
Now let's not forget that Republicans lied about Medicare before the election, and now their constituents basically are making them look foolish at their own town hall meetings. Watch how a great Wisconsin voter made freshman Congressman Sean Duffy squirm. Here it is.
The Ryan budget proposes to turn Medicare into a voucher program.
No, it doesn't. It doesn't.
Well, that's my understanding.
It does.
That's what
yes.
it is.
There's no
and the Congressional Budget Office thinks that's the case because they calculated the extra cost to seniors if it goes into a voucher program, and it's going to be trillions of dollars for those of us, for those young men like this fellow up here in front, who are going to have to pay more.
Listen, first of all, it's a premium support. It's not a voucher. But let me tell you this. The bottom line is, if we do nothing, you can all say, listen, I ain't come and tell you, this is all fine and dandy. It's all going to work. You know, you can get it. And I don't know, any young people here, you can all get this program.
You can get it, Congressman. You can get it. You can get it, but the voters can't get it. Premium support? No, Congressman, that's what you have. See, the constituents don't have premium support. That's what they're calling it now. Premium support. Now, come on, folks. You mean to tell me that the Ryan budget has in it that it's going to be a $6,000 cut on average to seniors across this country, and they're out there on the campaign trail trying to sell this 80% crowd that there is something premium about that? We have got two big stories tonight. Now, just hold it a second. I was going to go to Kenosha, Wisconsin today, but I couldn't because I'm afraid I would have said something that would have gotten me in trouble. That's how passionate I am about this, because Paul Ryan is out there saying stuff that is not true. We're going to get into his budget plan tonight. And John Boehner is flat out lying about taxing oil companies. Oh, this is a hot one. It's the Ed Show. Let's get to work.
My hope to you is that you actually listen to what we're saying in this room and not listen to the high-priced lobbyists like the Heritage Foundation back in Washington. This is middle-class America right here. This is middle-class America.
The Paul Ryan listening tour rolls on. Our cameras were there. You do not want to miss a second of this.
Great to have you with us tonight, folks. This is story number one that has me fired up tonight. It's all about what's going on in Wisconsin. Congressman Paul Ryan, he got an earful, and he should, at town after town, listening at his listening session in Kenosha, Wisconsin today. The House budget chairman, he did his absolute best trying to sell this plan, but most of the crowd, well, they just didn't buy it.
I really appreciate you coming out here today to this listening session. My hope to you is that you actually listen to what we're saying in this room and not listen to the high-priced lobbyists like the Heritage Foundation back in Washington. This is middle-class America right here. This is middle-class America. Now, if I'm understanding your plan right, you want to take a publicly administered program such as Medicare and turn it over to a private corporation.
Well, can I get you right there? So about a fourth of Medicare is already administered this way.
Correct.
Medicare beneficiaries who have supplemental insurance, it's administered this way. The prescription drug benefit for all Part D is administered this way. So most of Medicare is already administered this way.
So why the big change? Why the big change? Ryan was on the defensive over his path to prosperity budget all day, which the House passed, of course, back on April 15th. And every time Ryan gets a tough question, he loves to go to this chart that he's peddling at all his town hall meetings. This, of course, is the chart that was provided by the Heritage Foundation. Let's look at this chart. This is how good it was for Medicare, 50, 60, 70, 80, 1990, 2000. But now we're into the real redneck conservative years. They want to change everything. They want to get the New Deal. This is part of the New Deal they want to erase. So this path to prosperity, which I think we ought to be calling, is the path to the poorhouse. They want to turn this down, and they want to reduce the benefits, and this is how it's going to look in 2020, 30, 40, and 50. Ryan is peddling that his budget will make the expenses be right here and not go up here over the years. He has no proof of that. Here's what we do have proof of, is that they're going to take the benefits away from you, and they're going to give the tax breaks to the top 2%. That's what this plan is all about. This plan is about denying care to people to the tune of $6,000 to $7,000 a year. Are you ready to serve that up, middle classers? We should point out that the median income in this district is just over $50,000 a year. And do you think those folks are ready to serve up $6,000 or $7,000 a year in their Medicare years? Ryan's budget chart, it can't hide. It can't hide from this number. 80% of Americans, they want to keep Medicare and Medicaid as is. Now, this Kenosha town hall had some heart and some passion to it, and the people that were there were more excited about a plan one of Ryan's constituents laid out.
Do not renew the Bush tax credit for the wealthy.
Does anybody agree with that? I'm just kidding.
Eliminate all pork in all political districts immediately.
Yeah, I
agree with that.
Tax corporations and oversee profits and bring the jobs home.
Okay.
Place a windfall tax on oil companies and rescind the $4 billion subsidy.
Oh, we didn't get an answer on that? There was silence after that. Ryan tried, in fact, to turn the conversation around to President Obama. He accused the president of using political rhetoric.
I don't think the president is interested in negotiating on some of these big issues from based on some of his rhetoric. I hope that changes. I hope he does change his rhetoric, and I hope he changes his tune. I thought that speech was excessively partisan, very much inaccurate, and inadequate to fix the problem. And so I hope he does change. I, for one, don't think it's productive to get into a partisan bickering match with him on these issues. We got bigger things to do than do that.
Now, did you catch that? That President Obama is not willing to negotiate? Can we go back to the board? You know why President Obama should not be negotiating? Is because 80% of the American people want it the way it is. They don't want any changes. If the Republicans had 80% of the people on their side, do you think they would be negotiating to change? Watch how Ryan used political rhetoric to slap down the very next Wisconsinite with the facts.
You voted to defund Planned Parenthood, which would take away health care for American women who cannot afford to pay it on their own. You also voted to repeal the Affordable Care Act, which according to...
That's Obamacare you're talking about.
Wow, right. Come on. Let's not be partisan.
All right. I'm just trying to say, just so people know what you're talking about, the president's health care law.
Now, we're trying to be civil, so instead of calling it Obamacare, I'm calling it what it actually
okay.
is.
Okay.
Yeah, you see, he was calling it the name of the bill, but it was the congressman who was calling it Obamacare after he had said, let's knock off the political rhetoric. The voters of Wisconsin have had enough of the Republican lies that have been out there on this, but that didn't stop Ryan. Listen to this garbage.
These aren't coupons, they're not vouchers. They're Medicare-approved insurance options, just like Medicare Advantage works today, just like the plan you and I are in, just like the prescription drug benefit works. It's not a coupon. It's not a voucher.
You know what the bottom line here, folks, is? They think you're stupid. They think that you don't know what a voucher is. They think that you don't know what privatization is. They think that you don't know enough about health care in this country to make your own decision. They think you don't understand a voucher. You know what is really I think, frightening about all of this is that we actually have elected officials who are out there trying to take away from the people, these people right here, the next 10, 20, 30, 40 years, to take away their benefits while they go untouched. Let's talk about Ryan's situation for a moment. Let's see, he's been in the Congress since 1999. He's 41 years old. They have this thing in the Congress, the 50-20. If you're 50 years old and you've been in the Congress for 20 years, you get a hell of a pension. And you get your health care. And you know what? All of those folks that were at that town hall meeting, they don't have the ability to cut any of that for that congressman. It's guaranteed. See, this used to be guaranteed, and 80% of the people want it guaranteed because they paid into it for years. But now we've got these radicals, and I praise the president for saying that it's a radical budget, because that's exactly what it is. And if your mom is in assisted living, and if your mom and your dad are on Medicare and they're on a fixed budget and they got a kitchen table issue week after week, month after month, and you've got a congressman up there who's got a guaranteed pension, who's got guaranteed health care, who can't get touched, and wants to take it away from them and give it to the rich. Notice how the Republicans never say anything about controlling health care costs or investing in education to make sure that we have enough. You see, that would take us down the road of universal health care. You know, and then he's purporting these other ideas out there. The arrogance just pours off this congressman. It's a cool arrogance. There's a lot of different ways to be arrogant. Now, we were talking about redheads last night. I can show you how a redhead gets arrogant. I'm pretty good at that sometimes. But this is a cool arrogance. This is an arrogance where he says, listen to this soundbite, that the people really don't understand anything. Here it is.
It's people who don't understand what we're doing with Medicare. What I find is there's a lot of demagoguery and distortion occurring.
A lot of distortion occurring? Tell me, are the benefits going to be the same, Congressman? Let's have a definition. The answer is no. That's the definitive answer. That is not a distortion. That is a fact. You are cutting people's benefits. That's what's in your plan. That's what you want to do to the elderly in this country in years to come. Why? Because you've got this phantom budget that is going to blow up the record deficit that we've already got and make it even worse, because your chart from the Heritage Foundation says it's going to be bad. Here's the other one that gets me. He says he can sleep well at night. Listen to this.
I can go do something else with my life. I sleep very soundly knowing that what I'm trying to do is help fix this country's problems.
You know what? For years, people that had Medicare and Medicaid, they slept pretty well at night too. But now they're under attack by you, Congressman. And yeah, you can sleep well at night, because nobody's going to be touching your pension. Nobody's going to be touching your health care. All you have to do is take more money from the oil companies, take more money from the pharmaceuticals, take more money from the insurance companies, and it's going to be damn tough to get you out of Congress. So you've got pretty much a guaranteed situation, and you're asking the middle classers to serve it up more. For the top 2% who will line your pockets so you can get reelected, I think Wisconsinites are a hell of a lot smarter than that. I started this broadcast tonight saying that I really wanted to be in Kenosha, Wisconsin today, but I think I would have gotten in trouble. I really do. I probably would have said something that was out of line. It would have been the truth, and I would have made a spectacle of myself, so I thought I'd wait till tonight, 10 o'clock Eastern time, to do it. This is a lie. This is wrong for America. This is not what our servicemen and women around the country are fighting for. This is not freedom. This is a government takeover is what it is. It's forcing. It is forcing the money to go to the private sector and Wall Street so we can go through yet another shakedown. Do you think that's what Americans want? I don't. And you know what? When these folks go from here to go to here, they don't know about liberal and conservative. They don't know about Democrat, Republican. You know what they know about? They know about fairness. And we are lacking fairness in this budget, because they want to reduce the tax rates for the top 2% another 10%, from 35 to 25%. They want to reduce the corporate income tax. In fact, at Kenosha today, he even said that he wants to reduce the corporate taxes and reduce the burden on the job creators. Tell us, Congressman Ryan, what job creators are you talking about? Do you have commitments from corporations across America that if the tax rate is cut to 25%, that there are going to be guaranteed hires in this country? You don't have that, but you want us to believe this garbage? We're smarter than that. America is awake. America is alive. And I can't wait till 2012, because you know what? This isn't going away.
House Republicans are playing defense in their own backyards now over their plan to overhaul Medicare, the centerpiece of their budget strategy. Angry voters are attacking Republicans at public meetings across the nation to voice their concerns about protecting their Medicare coverage. Yesterday, things got particularly rowdy at a packed town hall meeting in Wisconsin with Congressman Paul Ryan, who is, of course, the architect of the Republican budget proposal.
You want to take a publicly administered program such as Medicare and turn it over to a private corporation. Well, tell me how my grandma's going to benefit from that.
Yeah, no, it's a fair question.
And they're asking the elderly to take on the insurance companies when we can't take on insurance companies.
Right, so.
Do you know anything about Medicare?
Well, I'm not on it, no.
That's what I'm driving at.
When I look at your budget, I see you cutting the things that I agree with, entitlement programs, but I don't see you doing across-the-board cuts with the military.
It's not that hard to find savings and cut programs on the backs of the poor, of the underprivileged, of those without lobbyist groups, and those without clout. I read this piece of document, and I saw nothing that really speaks to helping those who are already not able to make ends meet.
Do not renew the Bush tax credit for the wealthy. Tax corporations and overseas profits and bring the jobs home. Place a windfall tax on oil companies and rescind the $4 billion subsidy. I'll debate these points anytime with you. Just call me. My number is 262.
What was the last 97 what?
That's Congressman Paul Ryan in his home state. He had to change his departure plans, we're told, after that meeting. Got a little testy, some security concerns there for Congressman Ryan.